Hello, I'm Drake. I'm from Midlothian, Virginia, and I live with my two parents and my younger sister. In my free time, I love to watch boxing. I love Mike Tyson, and I love to run as well. Normally, I'll run 10K in a normal session. I also love to watch YouTube. Nelk is pretty funny. I'm hoping to gain some experience that I can use outside of the classroom. Because in high school, they didn't really have classes that I could actually use outside of school. I personally think public speaking is knowing how to compose yourself while talking to a group of people. My expectation of this class is for me to learn how to get better at public speaking. Honestly, I'm most nervous about the work. I am most excited to get better at public speaking and meet new people. Also, my favorite dessert right now is peach cobbler.
Hello, my name is Ray Carter, and my true belief is that success comes through failure. I know this personally because this is my 16th time recording this, and I have definitely not succeeded yet, so you definitely need to fail in order to succeed, in my opinion. I have had many failures, but I can't really say that I grew up badly. I had a great childhood. All I did was watch SpongeBob and I played outside. Yeah, so personally, I didn't get like pain through failure as a child. God didn't set any big goals. I think in order to have really feel failure, you have to set it has to be for like big goals that you set and end up failing. And that really motivates me to do bigger things and set my goals higher. Yeah, I always use my criticism to boost me instead of tear me down, which is a smart thing to do. Anyways, I'm kind of stalling because this has to be 3 minutes. But yeah, so my experience is in failure is my first job ever. It only lasted 3 months. It was a great, it had great benefits. I got referred by a friend. As a matter of fact, everyone there is a school friend, and they still work there with a crappy boss who at the time was the health manager there, and he falsely fired me. But I still take that as a failure because I still messed up. But it was a false fire. I got falsely fired. Anyways, 2 months ago, I wrecked my 2001 Jeep Cherokee Sport on the way to my grandma's in Lynchburg. That kind of sucked because now I still have a vehicle, by the way. So now I'm vehicle-less. Oh yeah, and there's another failure as well. My house got flooded 3 months ago as well. So now I'm currently living in an apartment. Isn't this great? So now I'm out of my actual home, and I don't have a vehicle, so I'm pretty much stuck here all day. Yeah, that kind of sucks. I don't know how to learn from that, but that still motivates me to do bigger things and set my goals higher. So yeah, failure is definitely needed to be successful, and I definitely fail a lot. This is my 16th take, I'm pretty sure. So yeah. Always set your goals higher and never be knocked down. And if you do get knocked, I mean, yeah, if you get knocked down, get up. I'm really trash at this, by the way. I'm not good at public speaking. And yeah, that's a good thing in my introduction. I'm not good at public speaking. So this class will be great for me. Anyways, so basically, my life is full of failure and I need to improve on that by taking the failure and putting it in just.
Have you ever been cut off in traffic or been stuck behind an ignorant driver, stuck at a green light because they won't get out their phone? Well, these things are really annoying, and you and I know that these are very annoying and aggravating. So these things have ended up, here's two stories I'm going to talk about later that ended horribly, and here's some tips and tricks that you can avoid not being in this situation. So 1,500 people die each year due to aggressive or road rage driving, and that's not good. I feel like this could easily be avoided, and I got some tips and tricks later that I'll use to help examine that. So yeah, it's important to learn these skills again so you don't end up like the drivers that are in these stories. I know how it feels because I've been in an accident before, and it's not worth the harm or damage to other people as well. To review, I'll be going over two stories and then some tips and tricks to follow. Many crazy stories have happened due to aggressive driving or road rage driving. Here are two stories I think that are beneficial to you, the audience. The first story happened in Florida in 2015. Both drivers were chasing each other until a driver eventually pulled into his parking lot. Then the driver got out and shot the driver that was following him. So, yeah, it's not worth it. A second story happened in 2013 in New York, of all places. The driver was caught in between a group of bikers. He ended up hitting the guy in front of him who was on a bike. Then the biker group got really angry and they followed him and started destroying his vehicle and then pulled him out of his car and then started beating him until he went unconscious. So, yeah. After my two stories, I think it's important that y'all understand it's not worth it and it's really not worth it anyways. Here are some tips for avoiding this rage. Try and take a deep breath. It's good to take a deep breath. It'll help calm you down in the situation. Try to change lanes to avoid the driver that's being ignorant on the road. Avoid using your horn. It will only make you angry and it will only aggravate everyone around you. Avoid using rude gestures. I know some of these seem hard. Everyone likes to flip each other off on the road, but it really does anger people and it's not worth the harm to you or anyone you're driving with. If possible, the best way to avoid it completely is just to drive off and pull off and wait till you're calm again, and then you can drive. So now that I've gone over some examples for you to avoid road rage, I'm going to go over some examples to avoid other people road raging on the road. So don't drive too closely. It's very annoying for me. I've seen people drive too closely to me. It's very annoying and I hate it. So it definitely makes me angry. So try to avoid driving closely. If it's possible, apologize to the angry driver. If it's your fault, definitely apologize if you can. It'll help conclude the situation and help the driver get over it. Ignore the driver completely. This may be hard, but if you can ignore them, then the situation pretty much is over. If in a hostile situation, it's not worth your harm or anybody else's harm. So call 911 if you think you're in a hostile situation due to aggressive driving. Lock your car doors to avoid fighting temptation. You're going to be really tempted to want to fight this guy or a girl or whoever if they're angrily driving near you. So, in conclusion, these things are very important. Aggressive driving and road rage driving are very dangerous and risky, and it's not worth anyone's harm. So, to help you to learn, I have given you many tips and examples and two stories of people who have fatally learned this lesson. I wanted to talk about this because I myself wanted to learn this, and I think it's important for everyone else to learn this as well. Because you don't want to be in a situation where you're going to regret it. I hope y'all have learned something from my speech. I hope it helps you in some way or some form. And yeah, hope it's helpful.
Did you know that people get away with murder, but they still get locked up for marijuana charges? I know, I think it's baloney. It's complete baloney. And law enforcement's reasoning for this is because they think it's a gateway drug, which that's baloney too. Their reasoning is baloney because it's a low statistic of people using hardcore drugs because of marijuana. It's a low statistic, folks. It's a low statistic. And I find this unfair and irrational to lock someone up for something that's harmless to people and them around them. And I've met many people because of marijuana who use marijuana. And in the past, they've been locked up for possession, and they're just as normal as anyone else I've met. They're healthy. They pretty much normal, like I said. And that's not fair. And I feel like it also benefits things outside the jail as well, like business benefits and medical benefits too. So firstly, I want to go over the rationale when it comes to reasoning for sentencing. A whopping, that's a big number, folks, 72% of Americans say marijuana is safer than alcohol or tobacco, which is pretty insane that we have two legal substances that are less considered less dangerous. If three out of four Americans say that it's less dangerous, then it is less dangerous to use marijuana. Yeah, and also the DEA says it's a non-addictive drug. The DEA of all organizations say it's a non-addictive drug. DUI statistically are more likely to be alcohol related than marijuana. Man's got keys. DUIs. Ding ding. Yeah, so statistically, using logic, if you're going to be a logical person, yeah, then it's considered non-addictive. It's less likely to be in DUIs. And it's not dangerous to anyone else around you. So why are we locking people up for this? Ultimately, legislation would not only be great for business and inmates, it's also good, got some pros and cons outside the justice system. A first pro would be like it's great for business. Colorado has been booming because of it. It's booming. And so yeah, it's great for medical reasons as well, as I stated. It'll help with cancer patients and people with glaucoma and also AIDS. So it's great for people that are outside the jail cell as well. To conclude, my honest feeling is that the pros outweigh the cons completely. You can't say that it doesn't because it just does outweigh the cons definitely and completely. So please consider my information today and just use it. Please just yeah, use my information. This is for the greater good, I feel like. Also, to recap, the benefits outside the jail, I feel like they just outweigh the cons completely because it's a harmless drug that doesn't harm anyone around them or harms themselves. So why would you lock people up for this? This is just unfair. Think of the families that lose someone because they've used a harmless drug. Yeah, like what are y'all doing? So consider my words today. It is for the greater good. And thank you.
Back in June, my life would change drastically. I remember it was 3 in the morning. We were staying at my grandmother's house in South Carolina, and we got a call saying that from the police saying that our house had flooded due to a loose cap in the shower. And that same morning, I also got a message saying that Amazon dropped me for my first day of work, which was shocking to me. I got no announcement of why, but they're a crappy company, so what do you expect? Anyways, eventually, about a week later, we would leave South Carolina to go visit the house to see what it was like. It was in shambles. The floors were completely ripped up and torn apart because they were drying the house. At first, everyone was doing a good job. The contractor was doing what he's supposed to. But about a month later, we realized he wasn't really doing his job. So we ended up moving into a hotel in Short Pump, which is about a 45-minute drive from where I live. So we ended up loading up boxes, which is a pain because it's a 45-minute drive. I had to go back and forth loading stuff. It was a real pain. But eventually, the contractor started showing his you know what. He was really defensive. He started hiring workers that were breaking stuff. Eventually, we actually picked out floors for him to buy. But he bought it from a shady company. And the floors weren't, I don't think, were the same floors. But I have another story with the flooring. So when we got the flooring, we had to put it in piles and organize it for the workers because they're so incompetent and knowing how to put the floor together. They also put a porta potty and a trash dumpster bin in front of our house in the driveway, which eventually would start filling up and blowing trash into the neighbor's yard, which is annoying for them and us as well. Yeah, eventually I would go cut the grass, and I found that the garage door was broken by the workers. It was bent like this, like a piece of paper. And the guy I ended up hiring to fix the garage said it was shameful what they did, and he was shocked that anybody could even break it that way they did. Due to stress, I ended up going to my grandmother's house, and I got into a serious wreck, a deadly one. But it really wasn't deadly because it was a deadly wreck, but no one really got hurt. I didn't get hurt, but my car was totaled, and two other cars got damaged as well. Anyways, I ended up going to my grandmother's anyways a day later. And then I went back a week later to go to the house to see what it was like. I also started college at that time as well, so it was getting more stressful. And the drama with the contractor did continue as well. We tried to tell the company that the contractor wasn't doing what he was supposed to do, and they said that he was a great contractor and denying everything we said, not trusting us, and he just left us with the same contractor we had. One day, we found that he left a booklet of our checks outside of the house. Yeah, he just left him outside, right outside, and that's just really irresponsible. That just shows his character. But my dad really got on him through emails trying to get him to do his job, and he got mad at that for some reason, not doing his job. Who would get mad about not doing their job? He got mad and started threatening about dropping the project because he realized that eventually the apartment we had moved into, that he could get us, that he would make us stay there until our drop date. He realized we had a drop date where they wouldn't pay for the funds to have us live in there anymore. So he used that as leverage to get my dad to shut up or telling him what to do. Yeah, that just really shows his character and how defensive he is and how aggressive he is. But eventually, we would stick up to him and do what he told us to do. That was our plan, to make sure we weren't homeless. We did that for about 2 or 3 more months, and then we were ready to move in. The house wasn't ready yet. It definitely wasn't ready. The workers were scratching up the floors and the walls. It definitely wasn't ready. The house wasn't complete, but we still moved in. And still, Judgment Day did arrive. The representatives for the company ended up showing up on half of the contractor to see what he actually did. And we showed them the pictures and the videos of what he had done. Yeah, one of the workers also, we had a porta potty outside, as I said before. One of the workers ended up taking a dump in my toilet upstairs when they knew the heat was on and there was no water, so they didn't flush it. And the heat eventually made my room smell like you know what. Anyway, that's another thing it did. The trash from the trash bin eventually started flowing over into the neighbors' yards, which was really annoying for them and us. Yeah, but eventually Judgment Day did come. The representatives showed up to the house, and we showed them what they did, what the contractor did, and they completely denied it. They said, quote, he was a great contractor up until now. We showed them pictures, videos, emails. And they still said all this stuff denying it, saying, I doubt they even fired him by now, honestly. I don't think they fired him because it's a shady company. That's why I'm not telling you what it is, because for legal reasons. But anyways, we called her uncle over to keep my dad from getting in a fight with the representatives of the company, because he was ready to fight someone. Yeah, we didn't want him to go to jail. Yeah, I'm still in the situation. We're still moving stuff in. But I'm just glad that we're moved in finally, that I can finally settle down somewhat. College is almost over, which is a good thing. Yeah, I think I can celebrate from my experience that I survived a car crash, that I've dealt with moving through 3 different places, and that I've balanced school through all this as well. I'm just celebrating that I'm still alive through all this, and that I've learned to deal with a lot of bull, you know what I'm talking about, a lot of that. But yeah, I am just celebrating that I have made it through incompetent workers, incompetent contractors, incompetent representatives of the company, like big people of the company, were ignorant and stupid. Yeah, I've survived all that. I've survived moving to 3 different places. Yeah, let's just be happy that I've made it through. And yeah,